much for joining the seminar. This is the last presentation. I will be very brief in order to finish and proceed with the question and answer session. I'm very happy to be here, my first time in China. It's a great country, a great city. Thank you very much for joining and for welcoming to this. I will explain briefly about TÜV Rheinland Mexico. Well, we have a general index, I will skip it. Mexico, as you know, is a country just next to the United States. We have a great position because of the location. Also, we have 10 free trade agreements with more than 45 countries. So we have a great network in trade that benefit our products in trade products around the world. TÜV Rheinland Mexico has 20 years in Mexico, and since back then, we started to certify to being helping certifying products and helping to get market access to the Mexican market. We are a huge market. We are the third world exporting country in the world. Also, we have a lot of trade because of this network of free trade agreements. TÜV Rheinland Mexico has 3 offices in Mexico, which is the headquarters is located in Mexico City, and we have in other 2 cities, big cities, industrial cities, which Guadalajara and Monterrey. Market access. I will explain a little bit the regulatory system in Mexico. In Mexico, we have the Mexican official standards. The Mexican official standards are issued by the government, and these standards are mandatory. We have other ones that are the Mexican standards, which are issued, can be issued by private entities or the government itself. But these ones are voluntary, unless they are referred to in a norm, which is mandatory, and they become mandatory because of that. The conformity assessment procedure in regulatory in Mexico can be done by private entities for some standards, particularly for product safety standards and telecom standards. For private entities, we have final authorization by the authority, which is the homologation, which, as you know, is the same in Brazil, and it can be the same in Argentina. In Mexico, it's the same. For telecommunication, we can issue a certificate, and we need the final authorization by the government in order to get it valid. And by the government only, which is certain areas that are exclusive done by the government, which is the sanitary, feed sanitary, and all that kind of areas.
Thank you.
Thank you. The usual procedure to get certified the product in Mexico is pretty common around the world. You need to do testing in a laboratory. The product has to be tested in a laboratory in order to, depending on the standard that you want to apply. Then, once you have the test report for that standard, you need to go to a certificate body in order to get a certificate. The regular requirements that you need to get the certificate is obviously the manual, that it can be in English or Spanish depending on the standard, the electric diagram of the product, the label, the prototype label, that you're going to put on the product, the HS code for import particular uses, the country of origin, of course, and the photos of the product, which usually is coming in the test report, and who the local license holder will be. This is very important because we can offer this service by you. If you don't have right now a direct client in Mexico, we can provide you the service of the local license holder. And then, if your client needs or wants the certificate by itself with the name on it, we can apply for an extension of that certificate. We can provide that another certificate with the name on it.
这一页介绍了就是相关墨西哥市场准入，然后测试呢是必须要有墨西哥认可的实验室完成的。那相关的样品的数量要求和时间呢也会根据产品的不一样会稍有不同。提交的资料包括说明书、电路图、名牌、海关编码、照片，还有一个很重要的就是要有证书持有者的信息，因为墨西哥的证书必须是。 墨西哥当地的法定的持有人来持有证书的，我们墨西哥莱茵可以提供证书持有者代理的服务。而且呢，如果就是你们后期，如果你们一开始产品想要出口到墨西哥，但是没有相关的代理的信息，我们可以提供。而且你后面如果是有了实际的客户 importer 在墨西哥的话，我们可以再帮你出一个 additional certificate，就是一个。 一个更新的证书，就是出给你实际的进口商的证书，而且我们这个呢，很快的就大概需要两个工作日左右就可以帮你出一个你实际的进口商的证书。等到。Thank
you. Then when you get the certified, obviously a maintenance surveillance is required in order to verify that the product is still in compliance with the standard. For product safety and energy standards, the value of the certificate is 1 year. Then we need to do the maintenance surveillance during that period. For telecom standards, are in the value of the certificate is indefinite, so it can be forever, as long as the product is still complies with the standard according to the maintenance surveillance. In both cases, the maintenance surveillance has to be done. And for product safety standard and energy standard, it's very common to do the maintenance surveillance between the 6th and the 9th month. As ordinary, then you can request for an extraordinary period of time to do the maintenance surveillance with an extra, well, usually it's an extra cost involved in there, but this can be done until the 11th month, not until the 12th month, because if it's not done until the 11th month, then the certificate can be cancelled. So this is very important to do before the 11th month. For telecom standards, maintenance surveillance can be done after the first year of valid. Then you can request to do the maintenance surveillance. Well, the certificate you can request to do the maintenance surveillance during that year. It can be done while the entire year. It doesn't matter if the second month after the first year or the 6th month after the first year. But it has to be done during that period of time.
墨西哥的证书呢，安全和能效的证书都是一年有效的。然后，安全和能效的证书呢，那每年会要有一次的市场的维护。这个维护是一般来说是在颁发证书之日起的第6至9个月进行的。那如果你有特殊的申请、特殊的情况，那我们也可以考虑延长到颁发证书之日起的第11个月。 但是如果在第11个月开始还没有进行相关的维护，那证书将直接被取消。对于通讯类的证书呢，通讯类证书是没有，证书上没有定义相关的有效期。那我们颁发证书之后，还需要到和其他的就是和那个巴西什么也是一样的，需要到国家的通讯管理局，然后去拿到一个颁发的 home location 的一个证书。 home location 的证书呢，每年也会要进行一次的市场监督。如果不做相应的维护，证书也会被取消。Thank
you. Well, the service is provided by TÜV Rheinland Mexico. We can provide the product safety standards and telecom standards I was mentioning before. And a certificate body and a certificate manager. I will mention the scope of TÜV Rheinland Mexico certificate body in the next slide. We can provide the commercial information standard. For example, the product has to if it's going to be commercialized in Mexico, electronic and electric products needs to comply with commercial information, which is the manual has to be in Spanish, the label has to be in Spanish and according to the Mexican unique measure. And it has to be the import, the information of the importer on it. If the product is offering with guarantees, the guarantee has to be valid in Mexico. You cannot request the client to go outside the country to validate the guarantee. And all the information that needs to be provided on the product once it's commercialized, this is the commercial information standard, and we can provide that service. This standard can be complied with from origin at the custom, or within the next 45 days, the product is already imported. You can be this service can be done in Mexico directly. You don't need to comply with it from origin. Telecom expert approval. When you're commercializing a telecom product that is out of the scope of a particular standard, you need an expert approval, which is an expert needs to verify all the information of the product and needs to issue approval, and this expert approval, which has to be validated by the authority in order to issue a certificate, and then you can commercialize the product.
这一页介绍了我们墨西哥莱茵的相关的可以提供的服务。首先呢，我们在安全、能效还有通信的产品，在很多的我们是有比较多的、比较齐全的发证的资质。 然后我们现在呢一些重点的一些产品，您询问很多的产品也在不断扩展我们的资质。然后这里还有介绍了一个关于 Norm024的一个相关的要求，就是在这个主要是针对于 importer 的，然后会考察相关的说明书啊、 label 啊，还有你的一些保修的等等信息。 然后还有就是关于通信产品的认证，我们可以出具相关的报告。然后，但是呢，报告出具完成之后和 Imetro 流程一样，和那个 Anatel 的流程一样的，还是需要到国家的通信管理局做一个验证，拿到证书以后，然后产品才能在市场上销售。Thank
you. Energy efficiency. We have three different scopes about energy efficiency. Energy consumption labeling. The product has to have an approval from the authority about the energy in current in volts that the product consumes while the product is in standby mode. For example, a TV connected and but it's turned off. Then it's something that you need to ask the government to issue this approval and for energy consumption labeling in order to be the product commercialized in Mexico. There is a list of products that has to comply with this regulation. Energy efficiency for luminaires and lamps is the same. There are a lot of particular standards for luminaires that use, for example, LED lamps or halogen lamps or Edison lamps that has to comply as well with energy consumption and labeling. And luminaires and for lamps applies the regulation. Potency consumption label, and this is a new standard that is not enforced today, but it's going to be enforced on after September 27. This standard refers ask that for the consumption in potency, which is in watts, how many watts the product consumes while it's in the standby mode. So the standard established the limit of watts that the product has to have or has to consume when on the standby mode. For example, for the TVs must not exceed 1 watt on the standby mode, or decoders must not exceed 5 watts on the standby mode. This is some examples I just put in order to mention how the scope of this standard.
这里介绍了墨西哥莱茵的关于能效方面的一些服务介绍。首先呢，墨西哥的能效有两块，一个是能耗 energy efficiency， 然后还有一个呢就是待机能耗 standby 的。然后 energy efficiency 的呢，然后这里有举例到一个灯具和相关电源产品的一个能效认证。 那相关的一般的来说，能耗的测试都是要在墨西哥当地进行的，就在墨西哥当地测试完成。因为能耗的标准就是关于灯类的标准都是有很多的，就不同的产品会有不同的能耗的标准，所以我们在这里就是标准没有帮大家举例出来。 而关于待机能耗的呢，这一块现在是目前没有强制，但是很快就到9月24号的时候就要开始强制实施了。那所有的产品，例如它会规定在墨西哥那个销售的产品要有一个限定的待机能耗，比如说你的音响设备待机能耗不能超过2瓦，然后你的微波炉的。 常规的微波炉待机能耗不能超过2.5瓦，然后其他的如果是有特殊功能的，不能超过5瓦等等。
The scope of Rheinland Mexico certificate body. We have the electrical and electronic products, the product safety scope. For example, we have the standard, the mandatory standard for electronic equipment. We have the mandatory standard for data processing equipment, and we have the mandatory standard for electrical products. And or each time, it's more or less 10 working days for electronic, including testing, or including another service that I will mention, and 25 working days for electric because of testing or because of validation. Telecom standards is 15 working days, including testing, for NOM 121, which is the older radio communication system that is connected with wireless frequencies. And NOM 151, which is the public network interface, for example, faxes and other kind of products that are connected directly, for example, to the phone line. And NOM 151, which is, for example, for companies that use, for example, the cable, but in the case of Mexico, the cable lines and for TVs, for TV channels, they can be comply with this, and we can provide the service as well. We're in the process of accreditation for NOM 032, which is the one I mentioned before about the potency consumption label.
这里介绍了我们莱茵墨西哥的相关的发证资质，就是我们莱茵可以颁发关于如下几个标准的，涵盖如下标准的产品，比如说 NOM-001的，是电源输入的家用电子的产品。 然后，这一类大概是一般是一些零部件的一些产品，插头，那个就是断路器等等，然后还有就是数据处理的产品，然后还有电器 NOM 003的电器的产品，就是家电的产品啊，还有那个家电的产品，还有那个手持式电动工具的产品，还有电器设备的产品等等。 还有通讯类的产品呢，我们可以发 NOM-121的，还有 NOM-151的，还有 NOM-152的，主要是关于暂停技术，还有公共网络的终端设备，还有连接，还有数码终端等等，就是发证资质还是很齐全的。然后我们的证书呢，有效性和 NOM 认证那个 ANC E 和 NYC E 的有效性是效力是一样的，然后价格会更优惠，然后时间上也更可控。周期呢，还有我们关于能耗的一些测试的话，资质还在申请当中，目前正在申请，然后如果有更新的消息，到时候再通知大家。Thank
you. Why TÜV Rheinland Mexico? This is the main part of the presentation. We have a mutual recognition agreement, which is an agreement that involves two companies, one outside Mexico, one in Mexico, in order to recognize the conformity assessment results. For example, this can be at certificate body level or laboratory level. For example, if a certificate body issues a certificate, I will mention the examples of the standards, issue a certificate of one standard, it can be recognized by another certificate body in Mexico, for example, in order to issue a NOM certificate in Mexico. It can be as well a laboratory level that a laboratory test report is recognized by a laboratory in Mexico in order to get a NOM certificate in Mexico. we are trying something different. In right now, we're trying to celebrate a mutual recognition agreement in a laboratory with a certificate bilingual, which is kind of different in Mexico. Nobody else has done this before, so we hope to implement this agreement in order to offer a better service for you. Lead time is obviously is short because you avoid sending samples. You don't need to send a sample for testing in Mexico, and the lead time is short, is shorter than usual certificate recognition. So you save time and you save money, avoiding sending samples to Mexico.
Mm. 其他分支机构出具的 IEC 或者是 UL 标准的相关的测试报告，那时间上呢就可以大大缩短了一个认证的周期，还有费用啊等等。
Thank you. Just general and just to mention a general example. For example, if I have an IEC test report for 60950 standard, I can issue a NOM. Certificate under NOM 001 or NOM 19. If I receive, for example, an IEC 60335 test report certificate, I can help you to get the certificate for NOM 003 in Mexico. This way, you can save time and money, avoid sending the samples as I mentioned before. This example is just a list, and I won't go detail because of time. But you can see in the presentation, what can we do if you have a test report in order to get a non-certificate in Mexico?
以下介绍了一些互认协议的一些范例，比如说 IC 60950的标准是可以被接受的，还有 60065关于 audio video 的产品，还有 60335家电的产品，还有 60745就是手持式电动工具的产品，还有就是其他的一些 UL 的标准。
Thank you. We have another service that is very convenient for you. If you have a CTUV US certificate, for example, you are exporting to United States, you can you can use this mechanism, which is the name of addendum. This addendum is under the scope of the North American Free Trade Agreement Mexico has with United States and Canada. And we can extend the valid of a CTUV US certificate in Mexico. And so you don't need any procedure just to apply for these mechanisms in order to the owner, for example, the owner of the CTUV US certificate can extend the right to use that certificate to an importer in Mexico without any procedure. Just a letter. It's just we can issue a letter, we can give you this service. Then you can move along the product from United States to Mexico or directly from here to Mexico using these mechanisms. And lead time is 2 working days. I need no documents, nothing, just that the right to use that certificate to import it in Mexico.
厂家获得了 CTUV US 的认证，那你只需要你在没有 NOM 证书的前提下，也可以出口到墨西哥，而你在出货前只需要将相关的证书 CTUV US 证书发给我们墨西哥莱茵，然后我们墨西哥莱茵会出具相关的 Addendum Letter， 然后但是需要注意的是，因为这个我们颁发的信并不是 NOM 的证书，所以不可以有 NOM 的相关的标志。 但是这个规则呢适用于以下的两个标准，一个是 UL 60065关于 audio video 的产品，还有一个就是 60950关于一个 RT 的产品。Thank
you. Conclusions. We have more than 20 years experience regarding the standards in Mexico. We can offer you mechanisms that can save you money. Avoiding sending samples in a more short period of time to get a certificate. We offer the localized holder service that can the product can be ready to send in order to send it to Mexico, and if you, your client in Mexico wants the certificate, we can also make an extension of the existing certificate. We offer a more personalized business with direct contact with our experts, and where we try to implement the new mutual recognition agreement, which I believe is going to be more make us more competitive, and we're going to cover more your needs, actual needs, in order to make more quickly business decisions as you need. For my side, it will be all. In the name of Tiro and Mexico family, I would like to say thank you for the translation, and thank you, you, for joining this seminar. Thank you for having me.
谢谢。现在下午关于拉美的三个国家的介绍已经结束了。那如果大现在进入那个 Q&A 的环节，如果大家有什么问题，欢迎提问。然后，so may I ask Rodrigo and Otavio to hear? 有问题吗？ Hello, Gabriel. Here we got one inquiry for the energy efficiency of for the Mexico.
Yes, sure.
Yes, for the she raised the question that you mentioned in the PPT we have only see the regulated product is the lamp and the luminaires. So we would like to know, is there anything else fall into the mandatory scope for the energy efficiency? Any other products?
Any other besides the luminaire? I will back to the slide that I mentioned.
Yes, slide 10.
This one.
Yes.
Besides these products, what other products has to comply with energy efficiency? Or just the part of luminaries? So just besides luminaries. Well, so far these are only the only products that need to comply with energy efficiency. Electrical and electrical. These are the only ones. But for example, for energy consumption labeling, there is a list of products. And it's public, and I can provide you that by email in order to send them to you. There's a list by the authority that the products have to comply with energy consumption labeling. Then for luminaries, for energy efficiency, for luminaries and for lamps are particular standards. For example, it's a standard for luminaries that use LED lamps, and it's only that is one standard just for luminaries that use LED lamps. There's another standard particularly for luminaries that use halogen and Edison lamps for energy efficiency, and it's another standard, different than the other one. And there's another standard applies for a general luminaries that use general lamps. So this is the end. But besides this, this is not the only ones the products have to comply with.
Because she's from the Nova, so she would like to know, is there any products listed concerning notebook or kind of products?
Yeah, printer. Well, as a matter of fact,
notebook
and printers has to comply with energy consumption labeling, which is the first one, which is in volts, that how many volts consumes on a standby mode, and also has to comply with the potency consumption standard, which is the third one within the law, that they had to comply with both, with energy consumption the labeling and with potency consumption labeling.
LED 和LED 然后 lamp 还有相关的 luminous 的产品，然后还有一些其他的 product list 都是要有墨西哥的能耗的认证的，其中呢也是有 notebook 的。然后如果大家有需要的话，后续我就是 Gabriel 那边会有一个 detailed list， 就是哪些产品有那个能耗的要求的。如果后续大家有需要，可以具体再询问。
Just to add something, the potency consumption labeling right now is not enforced. It's going to be enforced after September 27th. After that, you need to comply with. But if you have product already in Mexico, you don't have to worry about that. Those products doesn't have to comply with the standard because they are already in the market. This is going to be for the product that you want to export before that date, then you have, those products have to comply with the standard.
One more question. So, she would also like to know the detailed requirements for the notebooks. Like you mentioned for the potency standby.
Yeah.
For standby, so she would like to know, do you have the detailed technical requirements so they can know how to...
Yeah, sure. We can provide the standard also, but for example, the only requirement for the certificate, the testing that's going to take place with that standard is just they're going to connect, the laboratory is going to connect the product to the current, and they're going to measure how many watts it's consuming while certain operations, and on a standby mode. So that is the only test that this standard is requiring for potency. For energy labeling consumption, we can do the testing in Mexico, or we can use a foreign test report that has the value of the consumption in volts. That can be used in order to get the approval from the authority. But for potency, so far, the testing has to be done in Mexico. And the only testing that is going to be applied for that standard, they're going to connect the product, and they're going to measure how many watts it consumes what is on the standby mode. That's all that it's going to be for that requirement. I don't know if I answered your question, so I can explain
your question. The definition of the standby mode.
Oh, this step.
No, I know the definition of standby mode. I just want to know the limits of how many watts it consumes
for
notebooks. Oh, for notebooks. But in this case, the standard production system, if it's applied under this description, it don't have to exceed, for example, 2 watts. But for notebooks, energy consumption labeling, the notebooks are in the list of the product. For potency doesn't have just TVs. I didn't forget. I'm missing. And the notebook doesn't have to comply with potency. It's just TVs. TVs. And printers have to comply with potency, but no notebooks. Notebooks are only in the energy consumption labeling above.
So no monetary potency standby requirements for notebooks?
No, for notebook, no. For printers,
okay.
Yeah, because you say printers, and
I'm sorry.
No, printers has to comply with potency.
Okay.
Notebooks has to printers has to comply with potency and with energy consumption labeling. Notebooks just with energy consumption labeling.
My question is, what's the limit? Power limit for printer?
2 watts.
Two watts.
Yeah.
Actually, my understanding, the definition of standby mode is provide the power and power on the units, then power off and measure the power.
Exactly. The product is connected.
Yeah.
And it's off. It's enough. And then they measure how many watts product is consuming.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's off, but it's connected.
Yeah.
That is what they measure with the standard.
Yes, actually, all products we already declare the standard power, standby power, our nameplate for metrical products. I mean, the metrical products nameplate. We will indicate the power of standby mode.
Yeah, the printer has to comply with it, obviously with those hypothesis with current, with energy consumption. The current, the energy consumption, it refers to what? To volts.
Yeah.
How many volts
yeah.
the product is consuming?
Yeah, it, actually, it's tested by ourselves. But I like
okay.
to know, I wonder in the future, it's needed tested by the third party level or needed. Also, our results are also accepted.
For potency testing of in Mexico, for energy consumption, we can accept, we can use that test report you have in order to go to the authority to get the approval by them. But because energy consumption labeling is not a standard, it's a catalog that is a mandatory catalog published by the authority. In that case, we can use a foreign test report to get the approval by the authority. In the case of potency, it's a particular standard, it's a norm issued by the government.
Okay.
And then the testing must be done in Mexico.
So, Safi say after 2014 September. So,
yeah.
okay.
Right now, if you have product in Mexico, it's okay.
Yeah,
that
yeah.
product doesn't have to comply
yeah.
with the standard.
Yeah, actually, we have a new product. So, it's not a self to match to yet. So, for new products, we need to implement a new standard.
Yeah, exactly. If you want to make the export after September 27, the product has to comply with the standard.
Oh, thank you.
工业，我是三木公路集团有限公司的，来自台州，我在公司里面负责产品开发跟产品认证这一块。这次来 TUV 参加这次的研讨会，最主要我是想了解一下，就是我们的碎纸机产品以后销往中东跟那个拉丁美洲的一些要求。在这次会议上，早上老师给我们讲了很多东西，特别是关于那个中东认证这一块，因为这一块是后续我们那个产品营销的一个重点的一个研发方向。在这次会议上，我们了解了一个他们认证的一个流程要求等等，我感觉这次受益非常大，谢谢。
大家好，我是赵玉华，来自松下能源无锡有限公司。我们公司主要生产镍氢锂离子电池，那么我和贵公司呢有这个业务的来往，主要是电池的一个 CB 认证项目。那么目前呢，我们有跟贵司有合作，同时呢，我们有这个亚洲国家，特别是中东以及北美、南美一些这个业务往来。那么，所以目前呢，我们对中东以及南美一些这个认证呢不是很清楚。那正好就通过这次的这个学习吧，就是了解了这个中东和南美的一些认证这个要求吧。希望以后和贵司有一个好的合作。
我的名字叫 Ricky 刘，我中文名叫刘希，我来自苏州马街。那我们是隶属于那个霍尼韦尔集团。那我们因为我们目前的产品比较多，然后霍尼韦尔一直在收购那个其他的一些公司，然后有很多不同的类别的产品需要转移到我们那个苏州工厂来生产，所以然后这些生产也需要那个出口到全球不同的一些国家，所以我们在业务这一块有必要了解一下我们所有全球的一些国际认证这方面的一个学习，所以我们本次也两个同事过来参加一些这方面的培训，然后通过今天的培训，我们也学习到比较多的一些知识，包括中东地区，因为中东地区我们目前在英国这一块有相关的产品，有涉及到中东，特别是沙特阿拉伯这一块的那个业务要求，然后这一块我们目前有了解比较多，所以后续我们有这一块的问题也会及时联系那个 TUV 这边，然后关于那个其他，比如说拉丁美洲，那因为我们那个产品也是需要卖到全球各个国家，所以我们也需要学习拉丁美洲，所以这一块的话，对我们收获也比较多，基本上这样吧。 谢谢。
大家好，我是张薇，然后英文名字 Vivian， 我来自昆山三丰有电电子有限公司，我们公司主要是生产电源线，就是主要供应客户终端产品就是家电类的，然后我们大概需要有公司有大概认证单位大概有16-17个，都是我们自己处理的，直接跟认证单位相联系。我们的终端产品主要销往日美欧三大类。然后我这边今天过来，就是因为我们客户这边有要申请墨西哥认证，所以我就是我们有产品送到他那边去接受他们的那个承认吧，然后所以说可能后续需要申请墨西哥认证。然后据我了解，然后TUV 这边对于墨西哥 TUV 是分公司，所以这边想了解一下，然后有可能后续有合作这样。